a lot of problems, and I'm the kind of creative artist who I'm a composer as well, but I'm horrible with a blank slate. And I'm just a creator. I need problems and boundaries, and then I get really excited, and then that's fun because I'm solving problems and fixing something, I'm overcoming an obstacle. Then I can get super creative. And 10,000 Things Style is super problematic because you're constantly facing, you know, constraints. So that's where it gets really excited. So I think that's one of the things you're looking for in somebody, is that kind of MacGyver-ish approach to stuff, you know, and even musically. But like I said, it does work for me. It's not like a how-to. It's not like you have to do it this way. But I've done it for now over 20 years, you know, over 40 productions. So I'm starting to learn, like, there are things that work, and maybe it'll save you some time. I can give you some vocabulary that will help save you some time with your musicians. And that can be really helpful. Because so the way I got into this was as an actor. I worked with Michelle on a couple of shows as an actor. And then found myself sort of translating between her and the musician for that particular production. And it wasn't as complex as any of this. You know, those musicians, it was really simplified. But still, I could tell she would speak theater and they would speak music. And they were saying the same thing and they kept, you know, just missing each other. And I would sort of go, no, what she wants is this, you know, or what he wants is this. And they go, oh, of course. And then after that, she said, do you want to do this? Would you like to be a musician? She knew I was a musician as well. And I said, sure, I'll try it. And so, in the first one, what was the first one? Emperor of the Moon. Yeah, and it's grown and grown. And what I'm discovering is, and what Michelle's discovered too, and she talks about it being the lights, that I sort of keep pushing the boundaries, I think, of what it can withstand. And we haven't reached it yet. We kind of haven't maxed out yet. And because we had guest directors who come in, that also shows me different possibilities, because it depends on your aesthetic. Michelle is super spare, in case you haven't picked that up. She's very spare in her aesthetic. And she and I, you know, we do this great tug of war dance where I want more and she wants less. And we both win a few, we lose a few, and then we end up sort of right in the middle and go, oh yeah, that's what it should be. But I've had some guest directors who really want more, you know, and really want almost lush, you know, stuff underneath it and want little moments underscored, which is really challenging and fun. So it honestly depends on all the artists involved. I'm trying to be linear about all this, but I'm going to end up circling back and remembering I forgot to mention something. So, and I'm also pretty sure, like, when you leave, like, most of what I said is like, duh, like, yeah, of course, that makes total sense. Why is that a mystery? But simple things for me, like real simplicity, is really hard to get to. It's true simplicity takes a lot of effort to sort of get to it. And so yeah, the first thing is, so this is sort of this is not a sort of kit of like, here's what it looks like every show. This is almost like all my shit. if I brought all of it, Nancy would kill me. But I wanted to just sort of give you the aesthetic of kind of what I look like in the corner. You know, there's always a collection of stuff that kind of looks like a cockpit when you get in there. It's like loading into something because I have to be able to reach everything. And so that you end up surrounding yourself with your stuff. And that, because there's no sets and there's, you know, other things to look at, actually, this is actually an interesting focal point for audience members before the show sometimes, you know, to sit there and actually just take it in and wonder what is that going to sound like, and because they do know at that point, like, oh, that's the music guy, stuff's going to come from this corner. And it changes depending on the show, it changes up, you know, depending on what needs are. You know, and the thing that I found myself too with Michelle and doing this over time is, you know, music vocabulary shares so much with acting and with theater. You know, we talk about pacing, we talk about rhythm, we talk about dynamics, you talk about all that stuff. Improvisation, use the same words. And so for those of you who are not musicians, I'm not gonna try to train you, you know, to be a musician in this sort of session, but just to sort of let you in on the fact that you're musicians, you're musical. And because of that, you actually have access to what this could be. So why is it necessary? Okay, why it's enough steps to tell us where we are. We need something, something else. And sound is a great, easy thing to provide. Except that we can't take laptops into facilities, prisons. Sound design today is tech. It's all tech-driven. You know, that's where it's going. And this is going in the exact opposite direction. So we're kind of looking for, I think, you know, somebody with some acting experience who has some musical experience, maybe play. I happen to play a lot of instruments, not because I'm a virtuoso on any of them. It's just it's honestly, it only comes from a upbringing in upstate New York. Our school got a ton of money in the country for a music program. And so we had a tiny school, and so the band director made all the students learn multiple instruments so that he could have a band. And so, you know, you'd be in sixth grade and you'd have a baritone sax and a clarinet and an alto sax, and because he had to have that. You know, so that was actually the only reason I'm the way I am. And you're kind of probably also looking for somebody with some percussion experience. That would be where I'd start. Like, I'd start with your percussionists who are also actors. and if they play a keyboard a little bit, that's kind of helpful, but not at all essential. But the percussion stuff, there's such a huge palette. And most, if you get a percussionist, you usually get really excited about this kind of gig because their heads are always thinking, like, what does that sound like if I smack that? You know, what if I drop that? What does it sound like? And that's the kind of sort of inventiveness that really helps. And so the fact that this is not technological also kind of supports, you know, it's all stripped down, it's very bare and exposed, a really synthesized, hyper-electric, techno recorded soundtrack, you know, coming out of a speaker, I think it fights with the play, whatever play you're doing. I just think it fights with this kind of face-to-face acoustic acting that's happening. But what's kind of neat is because modern audiences, like Marcel's, you know, we're used to seeing people in movies and used to seeing music under it or hearing music under it, and you see up close acting, so that's why this is appealing. So to introduce like some subtle underscoring actually isn't horrible. Like you would almost in a big space, would feel melodramatic and overdone. But there's something about like also this intimacy, you have this opportunity sometimes to just bring something quiet up under the fact that these two people are seeing each other for the first time. Or, you know, and I can always, because I've done so many shows, I can only keep the last one in my head before I dump it. So I'll probably be referencing Electra a lot, because that's the last one. But, you know, we had moments of, you know, when Orestes and her saw each other. Like, there was just, we had to have just little things that told you that's a special thing between these two people. I don't know what it is, and that's the other piece that I know Michelle and I really do agree on very much is, like, I never want to, like, tell you how to feel with the music. I mean, in a movie soundtrack, that's kind of where you're led, like, you feel this way about this scene, or feel this way about this character. What I'm trying to do is, similar to the sets and things, is to provide an outline so that your imagination can fill in the rest. You know, and definitely giving you hints and kind of like orienting you maybe in a direction, but I don't want to fill it all out for you completely. And so that's why I got really excited when I was trying to figure out how to explain this, because I realized, so I was like trying to examine myself, what do I do, you know, in that specifically when I'm talking about outlines. I tend to use a lot of, so I'm going to talk musical stuff, and if it doesn't mean anything to you, that's okay. For those of you who don't, it doesn't mean something, that's cool too. I use a lot of open intervals and big intervals, so octaves. If you're not musical, octaves are like basically, think of like different shades of blue, right? They're all blue, but different shade. So, for example, so if I'm just going to do a single note, and I'm just going to use this sound up here for a second. Oh, sorry, thank you. That's just one note, right? But that's different than if I bring in that. It's just octaves. We're not filling in anything yet. And you can be like super, you know, bring in four. And it has more weight, it has more presence, but it doesn't have, it's not filled in at all. And then, so bagpipes, any kind of drone instruments that are very grounded and folk-based, you know, that sort of scream elemental, they're all going to be based, they're all going to have these, you know, fits, or they're going to have fourths. You know, and they just sort of live in that world. And you can do a lot. I mean, this volume pedal I'm using on my left foot, in fact, you can just like, you can bring it up really slowly, and then, you know, all you have to do on top of that, you know, is a, just simple kind of, and it wakes up the space a little bit, and you get into the air and that kind of stuff. So if I'm filling, so that's, you know, pulling up those kinds of things, those open intervals, I can fill in more. Suddenly, like, now you're just in chord land and music, and you know, now it's just, it's so interesting that you can go from outline, which is really, seems evocative to me, and then you go too far. And then you've tipped. So you kind of want to be careful, I think, of that. So what was I saying? So I'll just talk about that a little bit, just like sort of what I was doing there. If you're talking to a musician and trying to get them to sort of figure this out as well, is I work a lot in layers. So, back to the science thing. So, the whole reason the science thing works is, so the harmonic series is the science, is the physical reason why we have pitch and the way it works. So you take a string, a vibrating string, if you pinch it at the halfway point, you get the octave. If you divide that by half, you get the fifth. If you divide that by half, it does this natural thing where it starts with octaves, fifths, fourths. It doesn't get to those other intervals until later. So the basic elemental sort of sound that exists are those open chords, which is why we respond to them, like I said, like bagpipes, any sort of folk air drone instrument is gonna have that same thing. But I also do a lot of layering, and so you might wanna ask, you know, a musician, percussionist, like if I'm cueing an entrance or something like that. You know, it can be as simple as, the easiest thing, right, is just like a boom, right, or somebody coming in. Or, well, if you can layer it and add something else to it, so it's two things. Or you can do three things if you have a foot pedal to go. And it's not, like I said, it's not rocket science. It just sounds really more interesting to my ear to have different colors, you know, mixing together. One thing I started doing, which, again, you know, it's not, so you hand over, it's like a, which is interesting, it's got a bite and it's sharp and all this stuff, but you can do two, and that's suddenly more interesting, and then you get three, and you go back and forth. It's just a matter of like thinking of like the one thing you do is kind of like acting, right? It's like, you can't just go with one color all the time, you're bore everybody, but, you know, so what's the thing you're going for? What other shades of that are there that you can access, you know? And honestly, it's just something about sometimes just adding more, just adding more things to it. Now I'm gonna contradict myself, because I don't wanna make you feel a certain way, I don't want you to tell you how to feel, but sometimes you want to signal characters, especially if there's a real hierarchy of power in your story. So you've got either your buffoons, and you've got your royalty, and you've got peasant, and you've got whoever, that idea of like, how do you keep track of all these characters, this stuff can help so, so much. And Karen often, not all the time, but often plays like Falstaff and like every messenger we've ever had. Karen has the longest backstory for messengers you've ever heard. That's brilliant. But, you know, for like, so over in the corner here I've got, these are pieces of salvaged blackboard, you know, from a school blackboard. And that's also sort of goes in line with like a low tech thing. Like you can buy an expensive instrument, which then you have to maintain and be careful of when you go on tour. Or you can find a chunk of this, have a friend of yours with a saw, slice them up, and, you know, make your own little xylophone by putting it over weather stripping. And it's going to be way more interesting because it's not going to, they have pitch, but they're not tuned. And it can't, like, sort of it's not like I want everything discordant, but the less precious and the less refined everything is, it just, again, suits the style of performing this way. So, you know, it's a signal, you know, Karen happened to enter or something, might be as simple as, you know, and she's on and talking or whatever. Or, like a lot of times in the what we've discovered, you know, the Shakespeare, there's always the endless, what ho, Sarah? You know, because somebody showed up. And it's nice to be able to show up sonically and just with, what ho, Sarah? You know, it just seems to start to make sense. And then another thing, so I'm just sort of being in different directions, the long goodbyes in Shakespeare, like the I've decided to leave and I'm leaving. 12 lines later, I finally left. But they decided to leave when they said so. So there is that energy, that impulse to leave needs to be recognized. And so often we'll end up doing a thing of, you know, I gotta get out of here. They start to leave, but they talk a little more, but you can still do something to keep them activated while they're going, while they're going, while they're going, and then they're finally gone. Great. You know, that, really, it kind of helps. It just sort of, I don't know how to describe it other than, and it took me a while to figure out that one, because I mean, be listening to the, and here's something else too you'll get. If you hire somebody, you know, to do this job, what they'll start doing is they listen and they don't watch it. I almost never watch the show unless there's a sight cue that I'm trying to really line up the sound on, and that doesn't happen a lot. We try not to be too hammer on the nail for that, because that gets really cartoony. And when it's funny, it's great. When it needs to be funny, it works like a charm. Where was I?
You listen to the show.
Well, listen to the show, thank you. So I will keep my eyes down and listen, and I found myself hearing them leave, and I wanted to play, but then it was like, oh, they're still on stage. Why are they still on stage? I thought they were leaving. And then it dawned on me, it's like, oh, they have decided to leave. They're just still there. Okay, so there's this thing, you know, like in all your monologues and soliloquies and things, you know, if you're approaching that way where you're turning a corner, right? You're where does it, where does it do this? Where does it do that? Sometimes those can be moments of sound. And Jen is in here somewhere, right? Yeah. So she's so funny. She was just telling me outside that she saw Winter's Tale back in 2004, which I did. And we had a guest director, and she was really keen on underscoring. And I did so much more underscoring than I've kind of been used to. Could you talk about that moment?
Yeah, no, it was my first 10,000 Things show. I was 18, but previously I thought Shakespeare was very bland and overdone. And I see this show, and like the king's speech about being suspicious that his wife is sleeping with his brother. Like it was like starting to go on a little long, and then suddenly this like this just feeling of circling started coming musically, and I just it was
just a big. Someone who had at that point seen some theater as a teenager, but not a ton. Like it helped bridge the gap between being a film watcher and being a theater watcher, and it just made it so urgent going back to Michelle.
And it was really hard. I remember working, and I was going to talk about it. It's like we had to go through line by line with the actor and be like, okay, so, and it was about me conversing with him and saying, so you need to tell me where you feel those shifts. Where are they? So that I can time you. And that's something you don't, and that's the beauty of this, is like you can't pull that off in a traditional theater production. You just can't. You can't have a recorded soundtrack that accompanies the actor and that engages with the actor. So that's an advantage of this kind of work. It's part of that listening thing that Michelle was talking about too, is I'm so listening to what's happening here. And then I also find that audience members will watch me listening. And there's something, just like with the acting and with each other, it's an act of respect to listen to someone else. They see you listen, they see people listening to one another. It instantly reads as respect, flat, just whatever. And that becomes a thing, you know, that they're watching, and they don't stare at me the whole time. You don't want that. That's not engaging them, and that's a bigger problem. But I'm here, I'm not hiding. We don't pretend to hide. You know, we don't try to build a screen, or, you know, don't look at Peter. it's there, you know, and you just have to own that. Yeah.
With those shows, Peter, because you listen to shows so many times,
yeah.
You have frequently, well, not frequently, but sometimes an actor in the moment will realize that the shift happened to be later.
Uh-huh.
Are you attuned enough that you can kind of, oh wait, they didn't make a shift on that?
You know what? So the Winter Cell example is a super rare
example.
Like it was so precise. I mean, I had like words, you know, highlighted, a little code written to myself. Generally, I'm kind of, we can find a groove. You know, like it doesn't depart too much from that. And you start to, and they, I think, I mean, actors chime in. I mean, I forget to do things. I forget sounds, and it totally throws them because they're wait, what? You know, and it's really disturbing, even though the audience obviously didn't hear a thing, because that's why they didn't miss it. But they missed it, you know. So it's a big problem. So, you know, also logistics and limitations here. So there's the footprint of how much space I can take up. This, I'm actually getting really good at compressing it, so. But it usually, this is the max. You just can't take up. We're in tiny rooms sometimes. And, you know, there's been days where I've been in another room because I couldn't be in the room with them. So there was like a doorway in another room over here, so I would be like here. Like, okay, playing on things. So, and, you know, you need to keep it mobile. And again, do you want to carry it? That's still the motto. But do you want to carry it? And then acoustics. Because this is all about sound, right? And this is one of the best spaces we ever perform in. So we always look forward to coming back here when we do our public shows because it's live enough. It's not reverberant. It's not dead. It's kind of sweet. It's never like that. Mm-hmm. It's never like that. And so like it just goes from like really challenging to almost impossible. That's the scale we have in mind. And there's a couple of sites that are just like the American Indian Center that we've done a couple of times. We're still trying to find our sweet spot of getting in there with the right audience stuff, but they have this huge fan that they can't control. Nobody knows how to shut it off. It's on its own timer or something. And it just, you're acting, and then suddenly it shuts off. And when it shuts off, it's the most, you can feel. The whole audience just goes, you know? But it's also a reminder of like the power of silence. Like I play a lot with silence, and sound going away is super useful because. So we talked earlier about, you know, the fight scenes and dying. There's a lot of dying. So many characters die, especially and I do that too sometimes. And if it's a long death, which they usually are, you know, it's like, how long are you going to die, man? And I know I rely on this bass drum a lot. I mean, it's just a normal kick drum from a drum set, but if you loosen the heads so that it plays more like a timpani, you know, you can sort of tune it and get a soft, you know, a soft mouth on it. But what we also discovered was, so here's a bow, and down here I've got these three things called crotales, and don't memorize. They're just little brass discs that ring forever when you strike them. But you can play them, and they're sort of like a keyboard in that the sound will just come up, it seems to come up out of nowhere. If I bow it, it's just. It's a little pierced, and it's just, right? Those of you who are, you know, prone to headaches are going to be like, oh my god. But if this is happening, you know, it doesn't take much. And just to keep that going, and then. If I silence it, you know he died. Right? That was him dying. Because he was sitting there talking a lot and talking, and she was sad, and they were sad, and everybody was sad. And then his eyes closed, but you're not sure he's dead, because how could you tell? Except the sound stops. And that's, oh, okay. And again, you know, like I can layer that in with a note from here. Just even in octaves. If you want to. And it just, again, it's just that thing about texturing kind of deal. And you can also make, you can get two of them that are half step apart. just sort of lives kind of out there. I think you want to suggest to your musician that, you know, if they have access to any chimes, chimes are awesome. Chimes are my favorite things, mostly because I can play it and then go do something else, and it keeps ringing. And that's useful when you're all alone. You play, hit something and do something else, hit something, do something, do something else. These are just wind chimes that I, you know, took apart. They're just giant wind chimes from Amazon. And really powerful stuff. And again, I just figured out over the last couple of weeks. So doing some reading. So if there's any of you been elementary school in the last decade or so, and one of the meditation techniques they use now is a teacher will ring a bell and tell the students, you know, raise your hand when you can't hear it anymore. And they all stop. And they all just listen. And when it finally fades away, they, you know, one by one raise their hand. And not only do you do it actively, but you do it, your ear does it unconsciously, subconsciously. If you hear something like that, you're tracking it. Even though you're not consciously tracking it, your ear is going to track that until it stops. It's going to attract, it gets your attention somewhere. And whatever happening is on stage, you're kind of a little more in tune with it. You're a little more engaged. Part of your brain is listening to this, listening to this, you know, so it's keeping me there. So that makes total sense to me too, just like the large intervals made sense to me. So back to the chimes. So Michelle has this term, she calls wonder chimes. And I don't know what that means. It took me like 2 years. It's like, this is called a bell tree, Michelle. Like, I have to give her names. It's like, that's a bell tree. It's just like, well, whatever, wonder chimes. You know, and some of the sounds are like, I mean, this is not unusual. Like, that's like a recognizable thing, you know. And a lot of percussionists will have this kind of thing. But you can also encourage them to just occasionally, you know, play it this way. You know? It's a little, and it's a way that's not typically done. You know, they're like, oh, of course, I mean, just do it once in a while, yes. And then, in terms of their kit, like what they're bringing to the table, you don't need a percussionist who has thousands of dollars in instruments, and I discourage that. Again, you have to tour with it, it's beaten up. All my stuff is gross. This conga was nice once, but I didn't care. And the same with the cajon. But all my best cymbals, like this one, these two I got from a guy who was giving them away because they don't work anymore. This one has a crack in it, but because it has a crack in it, it sounds like this. And then listen. Hear how it just keeps zing, like it's useless to a musician. That's useless garbage. So, which is awesome. And this one's warped. So it just has that kind of thing going on. I did buy a real gong, because a gong is an amazing evocative thing. I mean, you can, it's royal, you know, it's, I mean, unless you grew up in, you know, completely off of grid, saw any sort of TV, you know, that would scream somehow important. Your brain would make sense, like, oh, that's an important person. But, so you can do it that way, but you can also, like, there's little metal sticks. You get the little zing where you hit it on the side. I'm pretty fond of that. Just because it provides a bunch of different colors. Back to the bow. So not only in the crotales, but if you need something sort of scary or weird, you percussionists will know how to do this. Where you just point the edges of cymbals to get really weird sounds. And this one, you have to be careful when you're doing this, because that one especially, if you do it, you'll get attention. You know what I mean? Like, when I do this, pretty much half the audience turns to see how I did it. So if they need to see something that's happening on stage, you need to like time it right, so they don't miss it. And then, you know, toys. I love toys. So the kids' xylophone. is awesome. Again, because the pitches aren't good at all. Mm-hmm. And you can combine it with the other one. So it's just, you know, some elements of that. The sort of shift gears a little bit. So some of what I do is a Foley artist kind of thing, you know, like radio play.
Yeah.
Like, I don't always do, it's hard to, you don't do like footsteps scrunching in the snow or something that, you know, specific. But, you know, if someone's entering really fast and they're running from afar, you know, it's not, it makes total sense to have them, and they can come on, you know. It just sort of helps us understand that there's, you know, somebody's moving really quickly. But also, there's so much of these, so many of these plays have nature involved. You know, when you're outdoors, how do you do that? How do you do outside? Like, wind is so hard. I've never figured out wind. The closest I can come sometimes there is the trick of using a hose, a garden hose, and swinging it, and it makes like a whistling sound. Except it's so, in order to get the sound right, it's so distracting. it's not worth it.
Wooden train whistles.
Train whistles.
Cheap wooden train whistles.
Cheap wooden train whistles are awesome. They are the best things. And then there's also little bird calls, which are also awesome, because you can just... And it doesn't take much. And if you have, you know, an actor with you and you can do two of them, you know, at the same time, it's just enough to, like, inform the ear, we're outside, it's nature, there's birds, and then you go away. Then you stop it. You don't keep it going through the whole scene, because then you want me to shut up. Tell the guy to stop doing his bird. This is a little thing called a cricket. It's a percussion instrument, but... Now, obviously, you're not going to mistake that for a real cricket, but it's about the rhythm of whatever you're trying to create. And doing it even... So here's another sidebar. Resonators, because I have no amplification. So there's this. If I do it behind this gong, it adds the echo, like it is sound like it's outside. So that's a fun little trick too. You can tell your musician friends. And then also this drum is such a cool resonator. If Sylvie, would you hand me that bell thing right below me, that's in the wooden block.
Yes.
Yeah. So it also helps if you have friends who are married to clockmakers. Karen. So Karen's husband Doug is a horologist, and I asked him about trying to create some chime sounds, some legitimate chime sounds. Because you can get a clock chime on most synthesizers, and they sound actually really decent. And even these work. You know, you can buy that as a clock, you know, that's okay. But I was just sort of trying to see what else I could find. And he came up with this thing using real clock parts. So if you hit it here, it's pretty quiet, you know, right? It's not going to be really useful in a big setting. But all you do is put it on top of a larger drum. So, and again, it's not like perfect, it's not like an awesome clock sound, but it's interesting. Mm-hmm. And I think that's kind of what you're going for, is like the stuff that makes sense, that makes sense to your ear. You know, this is my KitchenAid bowl. They make great bells. So I'm forever like going to junk stores and like banging on shit, because you can buy it for $2 or $1, and then it's useful. And then if it breaks, it gets lost, who cares? You know, if I bought a Tibetan ringing bowl, singing bowl, yeah, they're gorgeous, they're fantastic instruments, and then you have to be precious and be careful, and you kind of just can't. I can't get my editorial. It's too much effort for not enough payback. Talking about the lecture thing again, I was remembering the opening to that we had struck on. So the dilemma was, like, Michelle's in this, what she was talking in the directing, like, what if you just sit there, you don't know anything about this show, right? You have zero information, and you're just sitting there watching it. You know, the first thing that happens is you hear something. They've introduced it as an ancient Greek tragedy or ancient Greek play, so they know that. we sort of felt like it wanted to be sort of start out wavy because it is Elektra. It's got its fame. We wanted to sort of establish this is a story, it's a serious story. But then the first character that comes on in the Euripides version of it is this farmer. So like, so what is, how do we know that he's a farmer? We're not seeing him come on a tractor. We're not seeing him even dressed really overtly as a farmer. He just looks poor, looks peasant-ish. So what do we, how, what's gonna say to our ear that this man sort of is of the earth and does that kind of stuff? And our solution, my solution, that they accepted graciously, was sort of this. And it's never exactly the same twice, which is also why I love doing it this way. Like, I think the actors get to understand, like, what I do is consistent, but it's never identical. And that's kind of for me. I need to stay, just like the actors. I mean, I'm a member of the ensemble. I consider myself part of the ensemble. And it's having this conversation with them while they're doing it. And so, just as with the acting, right, you're consistent, but you're never going to do the exact same performance day to day. You're just not. And it helps me stay alive and to keep it from being, you know, strictly like a gig. And there's, I mean, I don't use this term, I'm not trying to be judgy. You know, a gig musician, I have many friends who are, a gig musician does gigs. They're fantastic musicians. They go from gig to gig to gig. What's the gig? Here's my job, boom, done. And then they sort of let it go. And it's hard for that mentality to work in this. That's why I'm thinking you're looking for actors, you're looking for percussionists because they never get to play all the fun stuff. They're usually relegated to doing boring stuff and they want to do the stuff they did in grad school or college that they don't get to do anymore. So anyway, back to the Elektra idea. So here was my sort of solution with the little transition involved.
Show you that.
that I showed it that I'm like trying to do like tricks and toys. Oh, so here's a fun trick. So we almost never do realistic, when I say realistic, like modern day stories, although we did do Doubt. And our guest director, Peter Rothstein, chose it, and I was really skeptical. He's like, oh, we're gonna do Doubt. And I know Peter really well, we go way back. I said, no, you're not. And he said, no, it's gonna work. I said, okay, all right. And super quiet play. I mean, you've seen it, most of you have read it. The sounds are, you know, crows, phone. We added a couple of hints here and there. But things like phones are really hard, super hard. And, you know, in a regular technical world, it's just a sound cue. It's so easy, piece of cake. I borrowed from the Jungle Theater. They had, you know, the old school kind of, you plug it in, and it was a real phone, but you could lift, there's two receivers, you had to lift one and it would ring the other. Unless you did something wrong and I never could figure out exactly what that thing was, because then you would lift it and nothing would happen. And then you would hang it up and then it would ring. And so, like, it only has to happen once to make you, like, gun-shy again. So I'm like, I can't do this, like, it's too stressful. And so the simplest solution for me was the best one, which was to take the thing apart. Because there's nothing that sounds like an old phone except an old phone. I mean, that's sort of it. But being able to control it is the problem. So we literally deconstructed it. And then just use, you know, some metal kind of a thing and just... And that's all you had to do. You know, and then you can control it, and then she picks it up, and there's not, you don't get the extra, you know, ring while they're still on it. Just screams out your hour, and you know, and then the actors glaring at you. The one performance we had, Sally Wigert was playing the nun, and it just didn't ring. It just didn't ring. It just didn't ring. And she circled her desk, and she finally caught my eye. And I was like, and so then she picked up the phone and called him. And decided to do that. But you know, so those are the kinds of things. Like most technology that I come across like screws up. Like it just breaks, or the electricity goes out, or your extension cord doesn't work. Well, this is a really fun thing, which none of you have because Nancy did it for me. But you can make one. So there's this thing called a water phone that is a real instrument. They used it a lot in scary sci-fi movies in the 70s. And it's got these brass plates, and it's got these brass rods, and you put water in it, and you swing it while you bow it, and it makes these really cool sounds. Mine makes ugly sounds, but I love them. Because when you hear it, you'll find out. And so I was looking at it for a long time, and it's like, so I gave Nancy a couple of stainless steel dog bowls, and then an old kid xylophone that I had taken apart, and she welded it together. It's always good to have a production manager who can weld. It's really useful. It won't hurt your ears too much, it's not very loud. And again, it's one of those sounds that's like, it's just so interesting and weird.
It sounds wicked this way.
Yeah. And then you can also hear it. It's great for loud. Something mechanical, if there's some need for that, I don't know. And this is awesome. This would be something worth investing in if you do a lot of Shakespeare. The official name is a geophone, but it's just ocean drum. It's just, you can just like spend hours, just like, but you know, like how many shipwrecks, you know, they need. But you know, with one actor doing this, and me doing this, you know, storm, doing that. Like, you get it. It's like, oh, that's a storm. I get it. Okay, I mean, they're sinking. And, oh, it totally makes sense. It just drops like a billion BBs in there. And it's as hypnotizing as it is to, like, watch. Yeah. So, I'll play with these later. I'll make them up. It's like that game where you had to get the Yeah.
People are like, oh, what's this going to be? But then you kind of go into your underscoring zone and have to kind of disappear. And I'm wondering if there are ever moments when you found it useful to be, like, are there moments where people watch you and it's intentional, or when actor musicianship is useful, or are there ever moments when it's good to, when you would like to draw attention to yourself as a performer almost?
Most recently, yes. And because we finally took a cue from, I think, both the public and the old world, we've been doing this with pre-show music to sort of just warm up the space, just to sort of establish right off the bat you're entering a different thing. And we've never done that. And when we started seeing that happening, it was like, my God, that's a great idea, we need to do that. And so with Electro we did. So we had some pre-show songs that Thomasina, one of the actors, sang. She's going to sing them tomorrow for you. And it was just there, you know, as people settled in. You know, it wasn't meant to be, listen to me, pay attention. But that always ended up happening, which was great. Because it sort of, people would talk and talk and talk, and then some would hear her. And then eventually, the last song we sang, which was the circle being unbroken, that was sort of like the show, you know, made the circle being broken. And so we were singing that, and I was using auto harp because we were sort of built because of the farmer and the rustic outdoor qualities. We just sort of ended up with a sort of quasi mountain country gospel sort of a sound. That's when, yeah, then it's, we're definitely doing something. And when it's a musical, that is a little different too. Like, because they're definitely aware that I'm doing more than I ever do because it's, we're singing. And we'll get more into details of that tomorrow.
If we all had Peter in our seat.
You do, you just haven't met him yet.
Exactly.
I'm not that special.
So the question that I have is, how do you go about looking for someone that does what you do? If it's a collaborative experience, and I'm directing something, I know I'm gonna have a musician, and I know maybe a couple of sounds, but there's a lot of unknowns.
Yeah.
In my search, what are some things to ask for? You know what I'm saying?
I do, and I think you start maybe with—
I mean, percussion I get.
Percussion. That's the, yeah, and start, I mean, I would start with your actors. That you, yeah. Like, I'm putting, like, just spread the word amongst all your actors in the community. Who amongst you plays?
Yeah.
You know, and you're not looking, you said, and most musicians that I know, or actor musicians, you know, they view themselves as actors, and they can play some things.
Mm-hmm.
They're actually really good at what they do when they play things, because they're actors, and so they're kind of, they want to do things well. They just don't build themselves as a musician, you know, so you kind of have to coax them into it. And like I said, like, the first Emperor of the Moon, I think I had like 5 or 6 things that I used to make noises on. You know, it was pretty simple. And this has grown in complexity as I've gotten more comfortable with that. And it's just, I think it's sometimes this matter of sort of coaxing them into doing more, you know, and saying, we can have more. You can, and it doesn't mean louder. It just means, like I said, layers are really, that's, for some reason, that word just makes, you know, it explains it for me. Like, when I'm doing something, like, I try to figure out, all right, I can do this and this. What else can I add to it? And it just makes it exponentially more interesting to my ear. Yeah.
I was gonna say, that was one of our first challenges when Caltakes first started doing the tour with, how do we find Peter? We actually, I think, because we had a grant, you came out.
I came out.
You came out and worked for the first week with the musician we hired.
Yeah.
And then he then did the tour and he did the next two as well. Because I think there is, like, all the other things you talk about, there's a learning curve.
Yeah.
But the person we found who was actually somebody I collaborated with on other projects, but he's like the kind of person who's done a lot of music direction for unusual musicals or like new musicals or like has done devising processes where there's like an actor's in the room and a musician. Peter, I think I wouldn't undersell your role as composer. Like, because the actor who can kind of play stuff doesn't get you the new composition.
Yeah.
And so, like, I feel like that's a really important element.
Yeah.
But what was important to me about the guy we found was that he wasn't a composer / sound designer. He was a composer / performing musician. So he had the timing and the musicality of the performer with the composer thing. But it was kind of like, he's kind of like a person I knew from New Play World.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, for me, like, made sense because he was going to be in the room for all the rehearsals, kind of coming up with it with us. That was my question.
Yeah. And Peter, you're with the ensemble at the beginning, and
While the rehearsals?
I was just going to talk about that. Yeah, so that's another huge difference. Like a gig musician wants to know, how many rehearsals do I attend? What time do I need to be there? What are the shows? That's how they work. That's how they, and when I employ them to work with me, that's the thing I struggle with. Because it just means, okay, I have to catch you up at some point. So for me, I'm in the room from read through till we close. I'm not always there in those first days of like, you know, working out the bare bones of their blocking. That's not that useful for me to be part of. But it's really useful for me to be there when they're talking about the characters, when they're talking about the story, when they're doing their back and forth, right? About, no, I think it's this, no, I think it's this. It's really good for me to hear the, you know, how they're wrestling with the story, because it's gonna inspire me to do something and I just don't know what it's gonna be, but I have to be there while they're working it out so that I can take that information and do something with it. And also, so there's the thing, I don't know the word for it anymore, but there's a, some musicians or composers, you know, respond to sound, they see colors and they see, they just see colors when they hear sounds. Yeah. I'm starting to believe that maybe I have like a movement version of it, because I watch, and I've seen, and just what I noticed it when I was driving south one time in the fall, and there were all those bales of wheat that they curl up in big ball wheels, you know, and they were scattered amongst the thing, and I could hear that. Do you know what I mean? Like, I actually could hear that rhythm of what I was seeing. And so then it's, and I started thinking like, oh, and that's like when I watch the actors move, and I watch them gesture, and I watch them, that actually, I hear that. And, or I hear something, or it makes me, you know, respond that way. And I can't do that if I'm not in the room, you know? So you have to pay somebody to be in the room the whole time, you know? And that's unusual for a designer. Like, why would you bring your sound designer in all the time, every day? But it's a different animal, you know? It's a whole different ballgame in every regard.
Can you talk a little bit, Peter, about the logistics of all of these pieces are so awesome, and I'm just thinking about the CEOs on the front gate going, no effing way is that facility. Do you ever have to say, oh, I guess I'm going to do plan B of that sound,
yes,
because we can't get this cleared into?
Yeah, and that's part of the lovely thing of layering, and I did, that was a bonus that I didn't plan on, which is if I can't take something in, but it's layered into something else.
Yeah.
I've got two other layers left. There's very, I'm pretty good with, I mean, it's always astonishing to me with the prison systems. A lot of times I feel like, I mean, they're all trying to do their jobs and they have their checklists and they know what they're looking for. And but I bring, you know, like they'll say no to the weapons, right, for the fight scenes, but they never bat an eye when I bring in a brass-tipped mallet, which, I don't know if you've ever seen one, like, oh my God, like, you take some, damn, they could be dead in a second. You know, it doesn't strike them as strange. Usually, I have to say that most of my stuff doesn't, sometimes the slates raise an eyebrow because they have sharp corners, and I have a box of them with a chain in it because we were trying, I think it was, and a lot, like I said, so this is all accumulated over time. I don't use this in every show. I've used this like once, measure for measure, because he's being dragged away and chained. Chain sound that, the chains alone weren't, didn't sound like chains, oddly. They sounded like chains in a plastic box. But then I shoved them into the box. But, yeah, I mean, I probably shouldn't have that. But they don't, when I describe it as, you know, slates, and they look at it, they inspect everything, they don't say much, so, until somebody does, right? And then when they do, then you're like, okay, keep it, I won't use it. You know, you sort of have to be prepared for that contingency, for sure.
Yeah, I would say the biggest pushback we've gotten is for things that record, so a looper,
right.
We got in once, and
yes,
then they're like, oh, we understand what this is now, you can never bring this in again.
Yeah.
And for our official music, we play from a really old orange blue box that is, that we can't order the tour anymore, we have to order it on eBay when I dropped it and broke. So we play our CDs from that blue box for official music, regardless whether we not have a musician. But yeah, I would say you can get way farther with metal instruments and you can with any sort of metal prop pieces. I would never be able to bring in that chain, so I'm like, wow.
Yeah, but they, and we have a long relationship now. So the one thing we ran into a while back, which sucked, was Shakopee Women's Facility down here. It's a state facility. inexplicably told us, we still want you to come, but you have to use all of our instruments. And we were like, what do you mean your instruments? Like, what are you talking about? So, well, we have a guitar, we have some drums, and we have, you know, when you have to use, but you still come, you just got to do your show with our stuff. And we were like, well, we can't, actually. It just, like, doesn't work at all. It's like, no. So we didn't go for a few, you know, like a cycle of shows, and we kept sort of pushing them on it. And my hunch, and I'm still just a hunch, I think when it, because once we got in and we saw what they had, and it was all very new, I think somebody advocated for getting these instruments for the women, so they could use them for their work services and for recreation. They advocated hard for them. Once they got them, they had to make the case for using them. Of course. So, I mean, it's all coming from like a really good place. Like, that makes sense to me. It's like, oh, they want these to be used, and they're trying to make their, you know, look right. I did, you need these. And we ended up having to use their guitars once for one of Kira's players. We had an electric guitar player, and she had to use theirs. And it's not easy to pick up somebody else's guitar and play it. They're not the same. You know, they're different. So that was the worst thing that we ever had.
I'm just going to throw in with the globe we've used music for the last three shows very differently every time. So the first time we did Much Ado About Nothing, we traveled with two string players who played three for the music and were also interwoven into the piece. Didn't have any issues, of course, with that. And then the next year, we actually traveled with DJ. So we actually got into the business.
Wow.
DJ and speakers and computer and everything, and did the pre-show and played, you know, and then with her playing throughout the show at different times, and also sort of doing the same thing but digitally. And then this last tour that we just finished, and weeks ago, this is speaking to using your actors, we hired actors, we had three of the actors all played guitar, they each brought their own guitars with them. And then we actually ended up hiring somebody to write original music to go with it. And so, you know, we had all the actors singing at one point, a cappella and harmony, but then we also had three different guitarists playing, and, you know, a classical guitar and two acoustic guitars, and we're able to travel with that. So sometimes I think it just depends on, you know, especially with the prisons, like, who's there at that time when you're taking things through. Because I'm pretty sure if you wanted to go back down to the DJ again, they were ready for it because there's some trust that's built there. But, I mean, it could be that I may have gone to a different yard at that prison and the captain of that yard had said no. So there's a lot of, you know, variables. It doesn't mean don't try.
Yeah, I think it just means have a backup plan. Yeah. You know, try, have a backup plan. Yeah. And Nancy and I are really good about learning how to describe things in a non-threatening manner. So anything that we feel might raise a red flag, we're like, how else can we describe this? That's still accurate, but doesn't, you know, raise any alarms.
Two dog holes.
Yeah. So before I forget too, we were talking about fights in the other section. You know, like, how do you deal with fights? There's so many fights these, and there's swords and knives, and, you know, and fighting up close. You know, how do you pull that off? How do you make that look like a thing? Not that we always do it this way, but often it will work. If you feel compelled to put it in slow motion, but the musician is in real time. And there's I don't have it with me, I can't remember what it's called, but it's basically a bunch of pieces of sheet metal that's all bent and warped. When you smack it, it makes this great metal crashing sound. And again, I never try to be like on the nose, like I'm timing it with their sword things, because, you know, like a cartoon, like ch-ch-ch-ch. But if they're in slow motion and you've got, you know, something going on underneath, you know, they're fighting, they're sort of doing their slow. Sort of expectation of it, and talked, the more we talked about it in rehearsals, and this is one of those examples, like, I needed to be in rehearsal from the beginning, from the design meetings. We were talking about it, you know, a year in advance. Like, how the hell are we going to do this? What's it sound like? And the more they kept describing it about how violent it was and how Elektra had built in her head how triumphant this was going to be, that this was a good thing, that this was her goal, this was, you know, what she was living for. The more it made me sort of just think hyper-romanticism and something, you know, very lush and rich and emotional that fought against actually what they were doing. And we ended up playing with it, and it was this sort of slow build that happened when they, you know, they started to go together. And I had also, and this is my composer part of me, these intervals here, that for some reason spoke to me. So I used that like throughout the first part of the play in little ways, just to introduce the earwig to kind of get you accustomed to it. But then, so by the time they started to get, you know, to gather her, to get her going, then I let it develop. And then by the time they were, like, sort of getting her wrapped up and with the way the staging worked out, and it was underscoring text at this point, where we just went. And it didn't go on forever, it didn't last forever. And then what was great too is we built it up to this huge climax and then it went silent. And then you got to like watch them deal with what they had just done. And then she was, you know, then they're of course immediately like, oh, this wasn't wonderful at all. This is not at all what we thought it was going to feel like, you know. So yeah, I would say that's like, that is the prime reason to get the musician there early, you know. Feel like they can be part of that that long, long, long process. Another thing about instruments.
Well, sorry, can I just add that thing real quick? So the other thing that was so beautiful about that is that was this is what probably they're doing one of the other room right now too. Is that we had a very elaborate set piece that was supposed to conceal the death, because in Greek drama, deaths take place off stage and then are revealed. And it didn't work. And it didn't work. And it didn't work. And it, even when we got it to work, it looked horrible.
Still didn't work.
And we got so friends. So one day I was like, oh my God, let's just try it without the cover and let's just do it. And because of the music, we were able to just cut the sounds. Like the music just carried the illusion of what was happening.
Right.
It was really cool.
Yeah. Which is another thing about the Greek plays that I'm just learning. I sort of like in George's camp about like stuff. Like I don't know anything. I learned so much by doing these and the Greek stuff. You know, the action takes place off stage. Then people come out and talk about it. I thought, well, I think that's that playwriting. We're not allowed to do that. That's really not a good idea. George?
Yeah, I just wanted you to talk a little bit about, because I find it, even just as a performer, when I'm in the room, when I walk in, I get distracted by everything, but really, but I am fascinated, stop it, by what you do, and yeah, it took you a long time to get to where you are, you know, but, you know, you started off by saying, like, I'm super lucky because I like one of the film with a bunch of things, and I know all these instruments, and I don't want anybody to think, though, that I think a lot of people could do this, or start off doing this, if they're rhythmic, and they, you know, it seems to me, because I saw Annie start to do it, right? Annie Heineken, who just really is a guitarist,
yeah.
You know, that's where she lives. And
she's an actress.
And who's an actress also and a singer. Do you know what I mean? But so she comes from like a musical, but she doesn't know how to play a ton of instruments either.
Yeah.
So what does it look like for you to, you put out the script and now you've got all these things you want to play, and how do you take notes for that? Like, How does, because someone else could start off doing this. I don't, it's really intimidating because you are so insanely talented, you've got so much awesome stuff, but I really think that somebody who just wants to be passionate about it could get there. Yeah. I really do.
And to find different things to do, and that's one of the reasons, so we, for a period, you know, so we do 3 shows a year, and it became a secret. There was a number of years in a row where I did all the shows. And A, I was sort of exhausted. Because this is hard work. You know this is hard, like it's like so draining. So, and also I was getting really nervous that it was just my voice. And it was just, you know, that's just not a good thing. And so we're trying to identify different people, and that's, and we put out the word with actors, and I knew Annie, and approached her, I was like, because she knew what I did, because she's been in a show, I was like, how about you, you know, and I'll help, and I can, you know, help guide you, but it still had to be her. Like, the thing I'm never interested in doing is like, here, hit this then, do this now, do this then. It can't be from there, it has to be an acting-generated response to what they're seeing, to what you're watching on stage, and it's going on, and that's why the listening thing is so important, and I tend to end up being a real diction hound, because I'm not watching, and I'm not even looking at my script sometimes, and sentences will go by, and I was like, I'm sorry, I have no idea what you just said. Like, seriously, I don't know what you just said. You know, and people go, like, what are you talking about? You know, you're so accustomed to it. So it actually helps you get an extra pair of super ears in the room for someone who's really, or listening to stuff that just doesn't make sense, you know, and they get confused. Like, my ears don't understand what you're doing. I was going to say something about instruments too. So this is my thing about, which is, so this percussion, and then I play woodwinds, not often in a play, but to me, because there's air, it's life. You know, it's an alive sound. And simple things like ocarinas are so evocative, and they're better than recorders. Recorders sound, even a good recorder sounds cheesy, like a 6-year-old. But these, they're not that expensive. And again, you don't have to know how, I don't have to play this damn thing. I can't play a song, you can't tell me to play something and I can do it. Do that, which is fine, and gets the job done, and gets it in there, and you know, people for years would call me and be like, I need an accordion player. I was like, I don't play accordion. And I saw you played it in that show. I was like, no, I played that song in that show on the accordion. That's what I know how to play. You know, I learn how to do what I need to do on the instrument I need to do it on, and a lot of musicians can do that. They, you know what I mean? It's a different, it's a way of setting up what is successful, you know. It's not virtuosic, it's not about your technique, it's about can you communicate musically on that, whatever that might happen to be. And most people can, you know. I don't do strings, I'm no good at that. I can bang on shit, because that's what Annie calls me. It's like, you just sit in the corner and bang on shit, I can do that. And I make stuff, I like making things, you know, I like that, so that's where the MacGyver, I think, piece comes in. I'm needing something out of it. Yeah.
Yeah, just going back to your comment before about starting out, I wonder if you could speak to maybe a toolkit. What are the five things that you would put in the band?
That's an awesome question. Yeah. Okay. I would put a gong. Again, like Amazon is awesome. You don't need to buy a $700 gong. You should not own one. You can buy a $60 one, $75 one. They're out there, you know, and they sound fine. You know, for what you need, it's going to work great. So I would do a gong. I would get a bass drum. And again, it's just a kick drum from a kid's. It's not a nice bass drum. And you can, because you can tighten one side of it. For Winter's Tale, I used to rent more instruments, I realized, because now I own them. But there's a percussion supply guy in town who's really been great to me. I rented a giant bass drum from him that put on its side on a stand. And if you can, you know, if you have that access to stuff, that because you're acoustic, size matters. Like, the size of that resonator is going to do something to the room, you know, and to do something here that you can't recreate on a smaller drum. So gong, bass drum, chimes.
Wonder chimes.
And then even just like a set of, and that's what we did too for Doubt. Whenever they had to go outside and we couldn't figure out like how we get, they're outside, you know, walking in the garden and the crows are doing their thing, and how do we know they're outside even? But just some quiet wind chimes, sort of like, we're like, oh, I think that's what you would hear outside, you know, it's from far away or something, and then we'd throw in the, you know, just the crow thing. Which, of course, now that I'm remembering it, I remember I was always like, because it's so freaking loud. And that's your other volume thing. So some shows, because I'm like, so normally, right, the seats are here and the seats are here, I have to be loud enough to be heard on the center of the stage. So these folks kind of get a pretty substantial show. But if I pull it back too much, then they don't hear anything on the other side. And so I've also learned to just, you know, depending on the show, if there's any sort of out of nowhere kind of crash, I just warn everybody. It's like about 25 minutes in, I'm going to bang. So just, and they were like, oh, thank you. Because I've forgotten to do that at times. And you can scare the hell out of people. And it will cause heart attacks. Because it's just, you know, I mean, if it's a giant, you know, everybody on deck, you know, kind of a thing, you know, where it's like, whoa, what the hell are you doing? So, chimes, gong, bass drum. You know, a snare drum is not a bad idea because you can take the snare off and it's a tom-tom. Or you can do the snare, and, you know, again, it's sort of like the royalty thing. Like, if you're trying to be, you know, military, you know, nothing's military, then even if it's anachronistic, you know, it doesn't matter. A sense. Like so many, we've had so many of our Shakespearean warriors like march in to soldiers coming to a snare drum, which, you know, like, really? I'm not sure, but it's okay. You sort of instantly understand what their goal is, and if we're going to cause war or march in for soldiers. Those would be great ones to start with. And, you know, I mean, so this, let me talk a little bit about this keyboard. It's an old Roland D50 keyboard that I bought from a former sound guy that got through when they were ditching all their instruments years ago for like $50. It's super retro. It's got great sounds on it. If you have access to things like that, because again, so like all these great sounds are good for nature and soldiers and war and fighting, but then you always have like, you know, the god or, you know, some spooky, furious, you know, in electro. And so, but if you have something that has some really weird sounds that, you know, you're just not, it's clearly not man-made, right? Because for somebody who's not a man, that's kind of what I reserve that for. You know, those kinds of sounds are really useful. Trying to find our furious. It's nice to have a little, that doesn't have to be a big keyboard. You can probably find a tiny little keyboard that has some really pleasing, bizarre sounds that can cover your bases there.
And those are programmed already into the keyboard here?
It is, yeah. And there's cards that slide in it. And I have to, when I bring it into prisons, I have to say, we learned how to put it on one line, which is Roland D50 with stand, cards, chords, and pedals, and amp. Because we listed it this way once, and they freaked out. So like, no, it's just one thing. It's just one thing with a lot of different parts. Let me bring it all in. How much time do we have? We're looking at under how long?
10 minutes.
Okay. A little discussion, if you want, about like, because tomorrow we'll talk about musicals, but music within plays. You know, there's so many of these old plays have music, right? There's songs. There's a lot of Me 12 Night has songs. And how do you approach those? And they need to be written, right? Or you use something else that exists. And how's it going to fit into the world of your play, right? And are you updating it? Are you doing anything to it? And there's great opportunities, you know, all that stuff, but it takes, you know, it takes a lot of effort. It takes a lot of attention. So for me, Michelle loves me, I think, for this, which is every time we get to a song, you know, this script, I'm like, does it have to be there? I'm not trying to be lazy. I'm just like, what happens if it's not there? Like, I always start with that. Like, what happens if this just doesn't exist? And then we talk about it. It's like, oh, no, actually, it has to. Something has to be there. It doesn't have to be all of it. It just has to be this much of it. You know, what they, it's all the questions that you would want to do in a traditional production of it, which is, why is it there? What are you trying to accomplish? Who are they singing it to? Did they just learn it? Did they make it up? Is it a song everybody knows? Are they good at it? Do they like singing in front of people? I mean, you get to all those questions that we should be doing all the time. We often get described, and you probably do too, like, you know, this style of performing, you know, they rethink how to do theater. It's like, no, just think it. Just think it, you know? You don't have to redo anything, just think it. So that's where I start with those. You know, I always begin with, like, does it have to be there? And then, you know, then you have to match it to your actor. You know, does this actor even sing? Are they freaked out by singing? Some can sing but are freaked out by it. Some actually can't sing but are loving it. and that's awesome. You know, that's actually really fun to play with. And then, you know, and so it gives you a chance, but it does take time, right? You have to sit. It takes up like half a day of rehearsal. Like, in the, what was it? You sang some song in Henry IV in the pub. There was some song.
I made it up.
Yeah, because you should have.
Right.
Right. You should have made it up. It should have been yours to make up. That's what, and like, we realized, was like, why should I make? I need to write something that sounds improvised and then teach it to you so that you can perform it in a manner that sounds as though you're just coming up with it. Like, really? No. How about if you just make something?
And I didn't make it up. Gloria Gaynor.
Well,
or Casey or something.
Sometimes I can trip. But, you know, sometimes it's okay to, like, let yourself off that hook, because I think, you know, just like we're not doing it in English, with English accents, you know, if you go back and do research and you want to pull in some Dowland and Bird and, you know, just, like, really want to alienate your audience, do that. I've won those songs that way, and everybody's just like, that's really not anything. So now I'm totally, you know, and that's a thing.
The choral work in As You Like It, when the servant died, like, I still remember that when everyone was singing harmony.
Yes. But it was simple. It was really short. And a lot of that, so a cappella.
Yeah.
Like, that's my thing too. Like, if we're in a play, you know, Feste is one thing because Maggie played her ukulele, you know, and that was great. That was a really cool thing. Otherwise, like, there has to be a reason why there's music coming from the corner. It's not a musical. We're just doing plays. So unless those actors can play an instrument, then you have to do it a cappella, I think, to make sense of the world. Unless you're in a scene with musicians. And that's fine. Then you've got musicians on stage. Or sometimes, very occasionally, because I still hang on to my equity card because I try it out once in a while. But we've convinced ourselves that it's legal for me to just come to the corner and stand and play something so that, you know, I'm visible. I'm a little more visible than over here, and I'm standing, you know, but I'm not on stage in the scene. I'm just over here standing. And then I'm not. And then I can go.
You could sing sounds, but not words.
Exactly. Yeah, I'm not going to say it. Yeah.
Well, the challenge we ran into when we did in Ilya is the script actually calls for the, he calls it the muse. And at one point, the muse appears and is there for the rest of the show and plays music through the entire show. Like, that's what the script says. And so the question, like, can we put him in the corner? And we're like, no, he can't be in the corner. He has to be in the circle.
Or,
like, he's part of the circle. And he played for the entire, he played 80% of the show with music. Similar but different way that you have to figure out how that sound sort of works.
Yeah.
He's got one instrument that he has to play for an hour and 10 minutes. So there's different approaches to it.
Like, yeah.
That worked, he built his own lyre, and then he had to figure out how to play his own lyre. And then he had to figure out how it didn't sound like the same five goddamn notes for the entire show. So how do I
solve that problem. But that's kind of brain you're looking for, you know? That,
yeah.
And there's, like I said, there's a lot of us out there.
Because if he hadn't been as much an improviser as a composer, it probably would have never worked.
Yeah.
You got 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you.
Can I throw that in there?
Sure.
You just made a perfect point. Find an improviser, a musician who plays for improvisers.
Yeah, you really want to.
There's a lot of them.
Yeah.
You want someone who thinks like a jazz musician.
Yeah, we did. So years ago, Kira did an adaptation of Crime and Punishment called Rascal. And it had a lot of songs in it. She wanted songs in it. So it's like, cool, let's do it. Let's do songs. And then, what do they sound like? You know, and then we started that whole conversation. And honestly, it was kind of quick. So we were like, well, here's this character who's improvising. He's like making shit up because he did this horrible thing and he is trying to cover his trail and he doesn't know what he's doing. And it's that scattered, very panicky thing, right? So we're like, okay, so jazz, free jazz, kind of wonky, you know, that stuff that you can't listen to for very long, you know, will be the base of it. And we had a bigger grant for that. And so I hired a bass player and a friend of mine who's a brilliant sax player. And I did percussion, and I was able to give them outlines of, you know, things, and even the songs were written sort of quasi-improv, like there was freedom within the songs for the actor to stay in control, because that's the problem with a song, and in musicals, it's a problem is the tick-tock. Once that's in place, your monologue just got ripped right out of your hands, because you're not in charge of your timing, you're not in charge of so much, and so we try to give it back to the actor when we can. But that really worked. They totally got it, and they were totally comfortable with, you know, I was a stab, like I would give the bass player, I gave him a bunch of sort of 3-measure riffs of bass lines that I thought were really interesting and fun. He could play them however he wanted, in whatever order he wanted during this one piece. And the sax player would just go on top of that. That works. It's that improvisatory thing. If you have somebody who really needs sheet music, you're gonna be hard. It's gonna be hard because they're gonna want to know. They're gonna want to get it right. You know, just as actors, right? I mean, you're sunk. You try to get it right. You just want to try to stay there, stay awake, and with them. So when I went to work with Olive, you know, and I went to public work with Jackie. I can't remember Jackie's last name. He worked on Measure for Measure right there. But even then, you know, like what those theaters did was. I, you know, sort of searched, found some folks. I sort of coached them a little. Like, I collected instruments for them more than anything and said, here's some stuff. That's what was really helpful, was like, here. Mm-hmm. And then letting them, you know, do their thing. It just takes time to understand how much you can take, you know, where's too much. Like I said, we haven't reached it yet. It's too much for your directors. Like, I know for Michelle, someone that she'll never go for that. She doesn't want, she'll want total silence. Somebody else will want a little sort of something to hold them up. But you can do a lot. Are there any more questions? Otherwise, I think you're coming down good.
What would be a good toolkit for an outdoor show?
Oh my God. So that thing.
So what would
you I'm trying not. I'm trying not to be, because I can't imagine doing performing outdoors. Scotty, like, I don't know how you guys do opera outdoors. It blows my mind. You're gonna need loud, big drums, you know, big gongs. I would love to be able to buy some really huge chimes sometime, like just a giant bang on chime. And I did get to do a production and helped Carleton College out. They did 12th night, and they gave me 3 percussionists of theirs, and it was a stationary play, you know. So on one whole side of the stage, we had just these big instruments, and 3 of them got to play, you know. So the size, like large things, just large stuff that you can, if it's outdoors, you'd like to be able to hang a gong from a tree, to hang big gongs from trees. Like to my head is thinking like that's what you'd want to do, like incorporate the, and like what's going on in New Orleans. Talk to the Cripple Creek folks. They have this space, sculpture space with their
Music Box Village.
Yeah, their installations that are musical instruments built out of scavenged, you know, stuff. Anyway,
we're just about out of time.
Okay, yeah. Thank you guys for.